Hello guys, my name is Amit Sani and I welcome you to this daily Hindu editorial analysis video. These videos, they come in the morning and in the evening, the PIB videos, they come. So the PDF you will get on the Telegram channel and PDF you will also get on my Facebook group of IAS preparation, Amit Sani group for IAS preparation. So there I also upload them. Now the motivation for today, it's never too late and you are never too old to become better. You will never find a better line for your life. It is not only for this particular phase when you are pursuing a career and preparing for the competitive examination. This is for whole life. Always be raw and always ready for a positive change. And you never concede this fact that you cannot do anything better than whatever you are doing today. And wherever you are, in what condition you are, you can never do better than that. That can never be possible. Because you will accept this fact that anything better you can do. You can learn at any age. If you can learn at any age, that means you can do better at any age. Okay. Health constraints can be there, but you can overcome many difficulties. So you are never too old to become better. So if the target is to become better, than age or any other constraint or any other condition is never going to be there if you are positive a person. And call on these numbers, ask for the StudyIQ pen drive courses. Exams are approaching and these courses are going to help you a lot in this phase, and they are created by experts and selected people, so there is no doubt regarding that. And the vocabulary, these words I found today in the newspaper, try them in the Collins dictionary and in sentences. Now editorials for today. You see, today's newspaper is huge. Many articles are there today, and we would go with the fast pace. Now, a national register of exclusion, the exercise of NRC is going on. And you see, many people, more than 30-40 lakh people are excluded in this exercise. And most of these people, they are saying that we are not Bangladeshis or we have not come from any other place apart from India. We are Indians, but we don't have documents, and that's why the authorities are grilling us. And in this article, the writer is saying that this is bewildering and opaque rules which are ruling this exercise, an unrelenting nightmare of wanton injustice on a massive swath of its most vulnerable people. People are uneducated, they don't have much awareness, they don't have money, they are poor, and they are disadvantaged. And these people, they don't know how to interact with authorities, so just they would do as the authorities would say something to them. So this is totally a situation where they are dependent on the behavior and on the attitude of these authorities, and these authorities are a real problem in this exercise. Because the issue is that selectively, based on religion and based on ethnicity, these people are excluded from the National Register of Citizens, and they are not being awarded the citizenship. That is the most important thing for these people, because when you are poor, you just need citizenship first, then you will avail all kinds of life support systems by state, any kind of scheme or anything like that, that is going to be applicable if you are a citizen of India. Otherwise the situation would become like the Rohingyas. So these people are under immense pressure, immense torture and immense fear. So these negativities are actually surrounding their life, anxiety and uncertainty about the future. That is the real issue. Just imagine their situation where in the rainy nights, these small kids of age of 3, 4, 5 years, they are carrying their luggages on their head, and they are not caring about the cold sunlight or the rains, because they need to survive, they want to survive, and anyhow nobody is helping them. They are just poor people and they don't react to these situations. They are not capable to react, and they don't react at all. They take these reshifting and all they as very positively. And in the case of Rohingyas and in the case of these SMEs citizens, in both these incidences we have seen people like this, and in both the cases people are poor, people are disadvantaged. So that is the issue here. And the humanity aspect is the major issue in both the cases. Here you see state is tackling the issue and the rules are opaque. They are not giving explanation about the bizarre points or logic which are being applied in this case. You see, some authorities, they can question them. They can again ask them to appear before them, and they can ask again the same questions to them. And even the urban educated middle class citizens would find hard to muster with these authorities. But and these are very poor people. So where do they go and what do they do? And most of them are like this. This article is regarding those people especially who are Indian citizens actually, but they don't have documents to prove their citizenship. So that's a really problematic situation. And you see, numbing stories of unyielding official bias and arbitrariness the writer saw on the ground. He went there with these important personalities, judges, and they found very different situation, which is officially declared always according to the official data. Things are going fine, but here you see the torture, you see the denial of due process, denial of total compassion. You see the main issue which is changing with respect to India. India's image is very humble image. It's a unique kind of a magical land where this diversity is possible. It is nowhere possible in this world. This much diversity, this many languages, this many people, this many color of people. So these things are unimaginable for any other country. And that's why we did not give any importance to luxuries or the material gains. We always emphasized on this diversity, on this happy living conditions. But you see, the same unique image we are losing very fast, and because of this political reasons and the religious intolerance, that is also because of the political reasons. Okay, so because of this issue, we are officially denying people their rights, their justice. You see the issue of this citizen amendment bill, where they are awarding citizenship to non-Muslims. That is purely on the religious lines. They are awarding citizenship to the minorities of Bangladesh, Pakistan and Afghanistan, where majority is Muslim population. But you see, it is not like that Muslims are totally happy and satisfied with their lives. They are also having they are also bearing torture. It is about the poverty issue that should be tackled, that should be supported by any capable person or country. But it is on the religious lines. And it is about the persecution of them. But persecution is also a condition with Muslims. So what about them? So that's why it's a religious lines. And that's why the writer says that religion is failing the equality concept here. That is problem. And you see, some bizarre reasons they are giving. If somebody is giving a somewhat changed name because of the language translation, maybe a Bengali name is different, name is different, and English name is different, somewhat different, then they are denying the citizenship. If somebody is named Omar and has written Onar because of his less education or less understanding, then if he is pronouncing Omar as Onar, then he is denied the citizenship. So bizarre this thing is. If somebody is giving 42 years of age in its document, then if that person is asked verbally, if he says, he or she says that I am 40, then he or she would be denied citizenship. So these are bizarre things what you are doing. You are denying citizenship, you are making them stateless just because of these foolish reasons. So that's the thing. There may be official difficulties, and there may be some issues where authorities are finding it difficult to deal with these people. But it is not like that you deny them citizenship or that you make them stateless people. And here, intentionally, these people are doing it. You see, there are foreign tribunals for the people who are coming from Bangladesh and all, and who are immigrants here. So foreign tribunals are there in every district. And you see, women are bigger targets because of their less advantaged condition, because of their less exposure to the society, because of their less awareness in the society, less education, and the main issue of marriage, where their place is changed. So this weaker section of women, they are in bigger trouble. Apart from that, some people, you see, when they go to work to different districts, and these people are from the state of Assam only, if they go to different districts, then their local police of that district, that declares them as Bangladeshi immigrants, and they are treated as foreign immigrants, and their case go to case goes to the foreign tribunals, and there they see all kinds of torture, they bear all kinds of official troubles because they don't have many documents, and they again and again they have to go to that district tribunals, and they need to produce these documents again and again. It is a costly thing to go there again and again. They need a bus fare and all, so all these things are really a huge torture for these people. And you see, when they cannot produce their documents of their parents, their grandparents, then it is impossible for them to get the citizenship status, because you see, these are poor people, they are again and again shifted to different places, so they don't have secure places to save their important documents, and they don't even understand the importance of these documents. So that's why many people who are the citizens, actual citizens, they are being denied the citizenship, and the sword is hanging on their head. That is the issue, and these people are so afraid that what is going to happen with us, because they don't have documents. That is the main issue. Next, NRC is not the only institution which is creating this havoc. Some processes were there in the past, in 1990s, when the issue of doubtful voters came, when CEC T. Session, he said that put a letter D with their names so that they can be declared as doubtful voters, and till the time, for a temporary period, till the time their case is solved, their case is settled, as the citizenship status is settled, then till that time you put a D here, and that was for a temporary period of time. Now this thing has become permanent, and because of this particular D, a particular doubtful voter D, they are being denied the citizenship status. That is the issue. And third one is by the Assam police, when they declare somebody as a suspect, then they ask for documents, and sometimes they don't even ask for documents. These people are saying on the ground that they don't ask for documents. Why would not we produce the documents? We are actually a habitual of this thing. Somebody asks us for the documents, then we produce that at any cost. But these people, these police people, they are not asking for documents, and they are sending this report to the authorities, and they are denying us the citizenship status. So that's a huge trouble, and again, double jeopardy they are experiencing. Means if one tribunal declares them as eligible for the citizenship, but the same tribunal again declares them ineligible because of without no reason, with inexplicable measures, they declare them ineligible, and maybe a different tribunal or these police department people, they would declare them as illegal. So for a same case, when one time it is settled and they are going through this intense exercise, for the same reason they are again denied the citizenship status. So double jeopardy they are experiencing, double jeopardies they are experiencing. And this opaque process where authorities, they don't reveal their procedures. You see, earlier there used to be retired judges to hear these cases in the tribunals. Now when this present government came, they appointed many inexperienced lawyers, okay, and they were never worked as judges. They never worked as judges, okay, they were never been a judge, and these people are made judges here. They are hearing these cases, and most of these people, they are associated with the RSS group and the BJP government. So that is why the people are alleging, these poor people are alleging, that these people are being totally biased towards us because we are belonging to a different religion, and they are focusing their votes for majority. So they are having some kind of targets that this month we will deny citizenship to this many number of people, and through this exercise they are showing their true colors, and they are totally taking advantage of their poor condition. That is the issue. And this issue of D voter and the foreign tribunals issue, anyhow they are raising these points, and anyhow in a hurried manner, they are denying the citizenship to these poor people. So that is issue. And one more, when in this process a lot of expenditures are happening and they are taking loans from these Mahajans, local Mahajans and local people, because banks and all own any other institutional authorities, they are not providing them any assistance. So they are bound to take money from other people, and they are paying heavily to these local lawyers, so that even so that at least their case is presented in these tribunals. Otherwise they are totally lost. But now the situation has become like this, that all of them are totally impoverished, they don't have any assistance, and they cannot even arrange the money, and these lawyers are not taking their cases. And you see, if they are given the citizenship status anyhow, after that they would live their life as indentured laborers, because they are having a huge amount of debt on their head. So that is happening. So these are poorly educated and very impoverished people. They are going through this particular fire like situation, and you see this bureaucratic maze, they are totally lost in it, because these administrative rulings and all, they don't understand them much, and totally they are taken for granted. Okay, so state itself is producing statelessness. That is the ending argument of writer, that state itself is producing statelessness, because these are official measures. And it's not an ethnic cleansing like Myanmar, where direct scrutiny is invited. Okay, and all the international bodies, they are going to attack Myanmar for this particular exercise. It is happening with the state measures. It is happening officially. So that's why this is state itself producing statelessness, and that is the main issue. Next article is regarding, you see, it's a relatable thing. This is happening for some people in India. Now Indians are being targeted in some other foreign land, in USA. You see, it's an American dream, where students or any other person wants to settle in a developed country, and they want to take jobs and employment there, and they want to lead a better life, because they see situation in India that is not much supportive, and it is for the specially for those educated and talented youths. They are finding it attractive to go and settle in the country like USA, because India cannot support much. Yesterday we discussed that they are not even able to pay a good salary to these teachers, and they are not able to pay good stipends and all these monetary supports to these researchers and all. So what they are going to do? They will certainly move towards these developed countries where they are supported. But now in this particular case, US Department of Homeland Security, they did a sting operation, and you see, they found 129 Indians that were willfully violating immigration laws to stay and work in the United States. And that was a particular very problematic thing, because there are two cases. Maybe these people are intentionally flouting these norms, and they are doing some kind of fraud, immigration fraud, or maybe the recruiters, who are mostly these NRIs and who are availing them all these jobs and all. So these recruiters are actually culprits. But in both the cases, they are now under a lot of scrutiny, and they may be deported again. And you see, these documents like I-20 student document, they are not being secured by these recruiters. So this issue is going on. So you see, it is all a common thing of foreign land. Whether you take the Rohingya issue, you take the people from Assam, their issue, and now the Indians itself and this educated youth who are finding it difficult to stay in USA because of these immigration laws. So one connecting link is there, that is immigration laws and the foreign land. Now see, indictment of 8 recruiters of Indian origin, that has also happened. But in this whole exercise, what is the learning for Indian policymakers? That you make these policy changes and you support your researchers, your educated youth, so that they don't flock to these countries, they don't have to go to these countries, and make this environment, make this ambience sustainable and supportive for these people, so that they get job in their homeland. They don't go to these foreign lands and they face this kind of humiliation and this hostility by the authorities, because protectionism is rising, and when Trump has come, he is all for this particular kind of protectionism for their own people, and his electoral basis, his voter basis is totally for those people who are demanding conservatism, who are demanding these outsiders out of America. This issue of Mexico wall is so huge, and it is only talking about the protectionism, although the drugs trafficking and all these issues are there, but it is the main issue of protectionism. So when these things are rising in USA, and it is not even in USA, it is in whole world, where employment is a major trouble and the local population finding it very difficult to find a job, and people who come from outside, because they are more capable, because they are more talented, they get jobs, and these people are disgruntled with that situation. So that's why this protectionism is rising, and we need to develop these employment avenues and these good salary avenues for our population, so that our youth, they are not finding it difficult anymore. And the issue of a demographic dividend that we are talking a lot, and if we are not providing employment opportunities here in India, we are not giving them these skill support system and these robust employment avenues, then certainly this demographic dividend would become a joke in India. And when these things are evident, that Indian youth is under immense stress and it is not finding support in India, that's why these kind of issues are much more evident nowadays. Now, America has lost the Afghan war, an important article. You see, we have discussed a lot of things regarding Afghanistan last month, and this article is actually talking about the history, that because of the geography, this country is troubled always, but nobody has got success in the land of Afghanistan, whether it's Britishers, whether it's American, whether it's Russians, all have got humiliation here, and they found nothing after a long struggle. It is giving the example of Anglo-Afghan War of 1842, where out of 16,000 soldiers, only one medical officer saved his life, and he came back to the British territory. Okay, so you see, this happened in 1842. I'm giving you a question here, find the location of the Afghanistan and its borders. You see, this is the map of India, and this is Afghanistan. And this is Pakistan, and it is Afghanistan. It's a landlocked country, and because on the north there is Russia, and from the west USA, and it was the British territory in the 19th century. So it was a great game that was going on. British people, they were aware of these Russians, who were a major power in those years. So due to this great game of territorial expansion, they wanted to control Afghanistan. They toppled the leader of Afghanistan, that was a tribal leader, and they wanted to resist Russians from coming here and take this territory. So that's why on this Durand line, you see, this is Pakistan and Afghanistan, that time it was India. So this Durand line was between Pakistan and Afghanistan. So a lot of confrontations happened here. And you see, out of 16,000 soldiers, only one was left. And these tribal groups of Afghanistan, they were so fierce, they killed all the British soldiers at that time. So it was a major humiliation for Britishers. Okay. And after 137 years, when it was USSR in the Cold War phase, it tried its luck. It sent troops to control Afghanistan. But after a decade, they came to know this thing, that they cannot overpower Afghan tribal groups, because at that time they were supported by USA. That time America gave trainings to these Mujahideen groups. It supported these groups, which created a lot of trouble in the later times for America. So it was America only who gave support to these important terror groups against USSR at that time. So it was the land of experiment. It was the land of proxy wars in 70s, but after a decade it became impossible for Russians to stay there, and they withdrew again. So it was again a humiliation, just like the Britishers experienced for the USSR also in 20th century. And now, after this attacks on America in 2001, this war on terror, that started by George Bush. And after this prolonged war of 17-18 years, America is nowhere at a dominant position, and they are totally losing this war. Taliban, which was the group against this terror of against this war on terror, started, and that time America declared that we will reach out to all these groups, we will destroy all of these groups, and there would be no terrorism left in this world, especially in the Middle East area and especially in the Afghanistan's land. So that did not happen, and now Taliban is way more powerful than it was ever in the past, and Pakistan has had supported Taliban, it raised its existence, and that's why Pakistan is also in a positive situation here when USA is demanding a support from Pakistan. So in this complex situation where Pakistan and Taliban both were going through a sensitive phase and they were finding it very difficult to survive nicely, but now the same country USA, who was giving trouble to both these entities, now USA is demanding their support, and Taliban, they are not recognizing the Afghan government, and that Afghan government's existence is actually nulled today because all political sphere is dominated by Taliban. They have capability to attack anywhere in Afghanistan today, and USA is bound to concede all the directions from Taliban. They are accepting all the conditions of Taliban, and anyhow they want a peaceful and respectable exit from here. Things are totally out of hand for America, and if America is failed, nobody is going to have a stake here, nobody is going to put their boots down on Afghanistan, and Afghanistan would be totally dependent on the group of Taliban. And if the same Taliban that was there in 1990s, if same Taliban appears again, then this area is going to be the most unstable area of this world. Or it is an opportunity for Taliban also, that it plays a positive role here, and it plays politically here, and it stabilizes the area, it gives democratic avenues to the people. But that is hardly possible because it has enjoyed the power of a terror group and the power of dominance in this area. So it is very unlikely that they would try to run a nice government here. And you see, everyone is dependent on Taliban today. All these stakeholders, they are ready to concede all kinds of demands of Taliban. And it is the country of USA that was most powerful one, but they lost everything here. Okay, and Indians are also very much aware of the situation, and we had discussed this thing in much details in the past. You see, this happened, these tribal groups are very much a complex situation there. Britishers in 19th century, they tried to topple this leader, and they killed the leader, and that was the Dost Muhammad, okay, and his son killed that protege put by Britishers, and they totally reversed the situation and killed all the soldiers of Britishers. So it is not any easy task to manage these tribal groups of Afghanistan, and you see, less education and the opium cultivation, these all are negative forces that are in a way going to push situations in a negative side. So Taliban's further moves after USA's withdrawal are going to be very, very crucial here, and for this whole area, including Pakistan, India and other countries. Next, the same thing is discussed here that I explained to you. You can find them in the points. Okay. It's an unsustainable war for USA. You see, in 16, they declared that we would withdraw from Afghanistan, but Trump had to send its troops again to control Taliban in 2017. But now Trump is also defeated here, and Taliban is way more powerful today. So it's all Taliban's decision in the future. Next, the issue of Rohingya. I discussed this issue of Assam and the citizenship amendment bill. The same issue of humanity is applying here, but it is saying about the international treaties. You see, we are not signatory to the refugee convention of 1951. We are not a signatory, and we are not even signatory of 1961 accord, of which USA is a signatory, but USA is not a signatory of this 1951 refugee convention, but we are a signatory of nothing. Okay, now see, in this situation the writer is saying that we cannot deny these supports to these Rohingyas, and we cannot deny our responsible role here just because we are not the signatory, because other convention, this particular 1951 convention is came out of 1948 Human Rights Convention. Okay, and Article 14 was there, and based on this Article 41, this 1951 Refugee Convention was established. And you see, India's repatriation of the refugee contravenes international principle on refugee law, because this refugee law is dependent on the Convention on Human Rights. It's a part of it. And you see, norms require that no contracting state shall expel or return a refugee in any manner whatsoever to the frontiers of territories where his life or freedom would be threatened on account of his race, religion or nationality. Means, if we can take the example of India and Myanmar, if these people are thrown out of Myanmar because of religious reason, ethnic reasons or opinion based reasons, maybe anything, so they have a great danger to their lives in Myanmar. So if they are hoping support from the big country like India, if they are coming to India, then India should not deny them the support. And you see, India cannot send these refugees back to Myanmar till the time the issue is not settled and there is no more a danger to their lives. So India cannot send them back to Myanmar. We saw this case in Syria condition also, and we saw this case in Myanmar's condition also. Both cases were having big amount of refugees flocking to other countries. So according to the convention, this is the rule. They cannot send back to the same country if the danger remains there. Okay, so we are now trying to push them back towards Myanmar. Even you see, in this case, Bangladesh also played a very positive role. Gave some space in the Cox Bazar area, which is near to Myanmar's border, where on an island they settled these refugees. So Bangladesh was better from us in this condition, but we are pushing them back to Myanmar, and this is all political reasons. We are pushing them because of religious intolerance that is created by political reasons. So this issue is going on, and always this protectionism issue is killing these poor people, these weak people, uneducated people. And you see, kids, as I explained to you the condition, these kids are crossing these boundaries in the winter nights, or maybe in the cyclonic rainy nights, and most of them, they are troubled, they are diseased, many of them are killed, and this is all a pitiable situation. And we are totally ignoring, we are totally forgetting the humanity issue here. And it is more a humanity issue, because these things are not enforceable. These treaties and these measures are not enforceable. No country can be forced too much, because they all have their own issues. How much we can support? We have our own huge population here. But you see, it is the whole issue of humanity that should be taken care of by a big country like India. Okay, so even the UNHCR, the Refugee Convention of 2007, it says that it is binding on all the states, whether you are signatory of this 1951 convention or 1961 protocol or not. You are a signatory or not, you are bound for this implementation. So we are again here flouting these laws. So it is not like that we are not signatory of this 1951 convention, then we are absolved. It is not like that. We have some responsibility, and these are official responsibilities according to the international treaties. And if we talk about our DPSPs, they're also in Article 51. We are to promote international peace, but the same situation remains here, that the DPSPs are not enforceable. Fundamental rights are enforceable, but in part 4 from 36 to 51 article, we have DPSPs, and these are not enforceable. These are suggestions for the welfare state. So that's why we should take care about this issue also on a moral scale. And regarding India, it is everything about moral situation. And even you see, if you talk about the issue of equality here, then Article 14 says of this Universal Declaration of Human Rights that equality should not be denied. And when this issue is religious also, so religion is also creating a big issue, and it is denying the equality here. So religion is not able to upheld the equality concept. So that's really strange, because religious values are for equality, but here the equality is denied. And you see, these are most persecuted people on earth today, most persecuted and most disadvantaged people. So there is no support available, and even these kids, they are finding it very difficult to survive, because no place to go, no place to stay. And Supreme Court has also upheld in this case of Human Rights Commission versus Arunachal Pradesh that equality should be maintained, and that is our constitutional law, that is our constitutional right. Next, our Foreigner Act is there, which was made in 1946. So we don't have any policy, we don't have any act after independence. So that's a big trouble. And this Citizenship Amendment Bill of 2019 is unmanageable by this act. So we need a major policy, we need a particular concern for these poor people. So that is the issue. Now, some facts which are there in today's paper, that average per capita emission of CO2 has crossed 20 kg for our people in India, for citizens. Okay, you see, in 16 districts, India emit 93 kg of CO2 per capita. That is very. And if we talk about the situation of Gurgaon, then it is 140 kilogram CO2 per person. That is really huge. And where the density is much in these cities like Delhi, Gurgaon, and NCR region, Mumbai, Kolkata, and in all these areas, in all these cities, per capita emission is very huge, because more rich people are living in these cities and they are using cars and vehicles, and also that's why per capita emission is very high. And you see, we have crossed the cities of China, which are conventionally called as most polluting countries, which are having per capita emission in huge amounts. But now the situations are changing, and Indian cities are topping these lists. So that's a huge trouble, and I'm giving you a task today: find out the NAAQS topic and the NAAQI topic. These are quality air quality indexes, and the Suffer app. Search about them on the Google and learn about their details and point out the differences. I would ask you tomorrow. Okay, next data is regarding the elephant corridor. What is this elephant corridor? You see, in the protected areas, these railway lines or highways, they crosses, and you see, these animals like elephants, they cross these lines and highways because they don't understand the traffic rules. Okay, so many elephants are killed, and these are not only animals, these are all kinds of animals, these are not only elephants, but especially the case of elephant is huge, because in these protected areas, in these jungles, mainly the jungles of Odisha and South India and Assam, eastern part of India, there the case is like, in these states, the elephants' numbers are huge, and in huge numbers, these are killed due to the accident with rails. Okay, so that's why it's a major issue, it's a cause of concern, and this Asian Elephant Alliance that is working for these particular elephant corridors. So this is a task for you also today: search for these elephant corridors in India, and in which states elephants are mainly found. And now see, out of 101 existing corridors, 96 are now coming together with these 5 NGOs and this umbrella initiative of Asian Elephant Alliance. It is gonna work for these corridors. And Wildlife Trust of India, this is a governmental organization which is working for this. Okay, so, and now next data is regarding the PM Kisan Yojana that I explained to you day before yesterday, that they are giving support of 6,000 rupees. It's an income cash transfer in the farmers, small and marginal farmers account who are having land less than 2 hectares. Okay, so this issue is huge. And now see, 2,000 rupees in 3 installments they are going to give three installments of 2000 rupees, so total 6000 rupees. Now they are making it mandatory for the second installment that they should produce their Aadhaar cards. So this mandatory condition of Aadhaar is again going to be controversial, the way it became controversial for many these subsidy transfers or cash transfers. So again, when many people would find it difficult because of this data mismatch, or some are not having this Aadhaar card and some are not registered and some are not able to produce their cards and all, or their datas and all, so it is going to be very difficult. And states have also been told to update their land records, and there also this condition would be mandatory. Okay, so a major article would come on this topic, so we would discuss this thing later. And next is regarding the angel tax. You see, these startups which were supported in the Startup India scheme, and in this Startup India scheme, you see, the major issue with startup is they are finding it very difficult to raise money for capital investment, because it's not sure that they are going to be successful or not. And these institutions like banks and financial agencies, they are not able to give them big loans, so they raise their money through these venture investors or these angel investors. Mainly these angel investors are their family members, their friends, or maybe some person who is going to understand their plan, and he's going to give them support. So that's why that person is called angel investor. And if this unlisted startups, if they are raising some money that is in excess, then this money would invite the angel tax, because it is on the angel investment. So angel tax would be invited. So this angel tax norms are going to be relaxed by the Indian government. Now they are saying because they are these startups, most of these startups are failing. Because of their failure, government is under pressure and they want to boost them again. So they are relaxing these angel tax norms. They cannot scrap this altogether because it is raising revenue. So it's difficult for the government to scrape this tax. But they are relaxing these angel tax norms. So that's an important thing. Now the MCQs, try them and put their answer in the comment box. And this today's newspaper was huge. So these 5-10 extra minutes are going to be very important, because these articles are giving you some important facts, some specific angles. So we cannot escape them. We cannot lose their particular facts. We cannot generalize these statements. Okay. And this map question, find out these important points and find out this expansion of Himalayan range from Hindu Kush till Arakan Yoma here. Okay. So thanks a lot. Keep watching, and I will upload these PDFs in my Facebook group. This particular group is there. Send me a request. I would approve. And next, thanks a lot. Keep watching. It was a mid-sense.